Forgiveness begins with you. Welcome to St. Paul's YouTube channel on the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. I'm Father Andrew, the rector of this parish. I'm glad you joined me. The lesson appointed for today is Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 to 25. As always, all the lessons are available from lectionarypage.net, and be sure to check the video description below for our September edition of the Good News, lessons, and the prayer list. As always, let us pray. O God, because without you, we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Jesus' teaching about living in a community of faith continues. Last week, he taught the disciples how to address conflict in the gospel. Addressing conflict begins with our courage to open up and share thoughts with whomever we have different opinions. And as I said in my last video, it is harder to do it than we think. It's easier to ignore, keep silent, or speak about it with other people who already agree with us. It's much easier to avoid facing the necessary conversation directly with a person. The lesson was about how to trust God, open our minds, and talk from our hearts with respect with a person. Then this week, Jesus speaks about forgiveness. When Peter asks Jesus, "Lord, if another person commits sin, how often should I forgive? 7 times? Jesus tells him, "No, Peter, no 7 times, but 77 times. 77 times, or some call it 70 times 7, which is 490 times. Now, that's pretty generous if you ask me. After all, how many times, honestly, would you allow yourself to forgive a person before finally saying, enough? Yet, on the other hand, I have also said, I have no trouble forgiving somebody. I do it all the time. I forgive my family or close friends because I love them. We forgive people who are close to us time after time. Sometimes we forgive out of love, and other times out of hopelessness. When troubling behavior continues, we become so numb to the repetition that instead of truly forgiving a person, we just let it slide because we don't want our emotions to be consumed by them. Now, how generous can we honestly be on forgiving somebody whom we are less concerned about? Are we as forgiving as we can be to our close friends and family? Now, we both know it's a real challenge. When it comes to an opportunity that requires real forgiveness, we become overly critical. At least I get that way. In my mind, I'm constantly observing and assessing whether or not a person is worthy of my forgiveness. And too many times, we question why we should even make efforts to forgive people when we don't see them even try to repent. Does any of this sound familiar to you? Jesus uses the parable of a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants to deal with this issue. A servant owed 10,000 talents to the king and was brought to him. The king forgave his debt after begging and crying for mercy. However, this same slave then went after the people who had owed him money. Not only did he go after them, but refused to forgive their debt. After King heard about it, he threw this slave into jail and changed his mind about forgiving his debt. King told him, "I forgave all your debt. Why wouldn't you do the same to those who owe you money?" The moral of the story is that we forgive people not because of who they are or what they did, not even because of what we will gain in return. Rather, we forgive people because of who we are. That is the disciples of Jesus Christ who set us free. Forgiveness is more about forgiving our own grudge, hatred, anger, or whatever the unloving feelings unreconciled in us. When we forgive to let go, we must do it not out of indifference, but out of love. It is about letting our troubled spirit go, and so that we can fill our hearts with love. Forgiveness does not depend on others. It begins with us. What does that mean? It means that our ability or lack thereof to forgive somebody depends on the depth of our acknowledgement and understanding of God's redeeming work that Jesus taught us. If we know, truly know, how often God forgave our sins and still be with us and love us, we should not have trouble forgiving whatever the sins that we see in the world. We can then fight the sins from the point of love and not of hate. Do you have anything that is troubling in your heart? How can you forgive yourself to let go of whatever the unreconciled, unloving feelings so that you can let God love you to become a more loving person? Amen. We had a wonderful 8 a.m. service this morning, even after a long period of a break and new safety precautions. The 25 of us gathered, prayed, broke bread together, and gave thanks to God, as if though we had never been apart. I want to thank all of you who work so hard to keep our sanctuary safe. And 9 to noon Christian service in the shade included our youth who volunteered to greet folks in front of the church. Many friends from the community returned to bring more goods. At the end of the service, we lifted up all those people on our prayer list, especially Elisa, Ryan, and his fiancée Allison, and Victoria, as they sent off our beloved master acolyte, Paul, who died of COVID-19. Elisa, Ryan, Victoria, and Allison, if you're watching, we love you so very much. Finally, we welcome back Andrew and Elizabeth from Youth Performing Arts School to sing Alive in Me. It was written by Matt Harvey, set to music written by British composer Thomas Hewitt Jones. The text relates to giving thanks for the forgiveness we receive, giving thanks to God who meets our limitations and our doubt with infinite love. In turn, the longing arises within to live and to love and belong. We raise our voices to sing this song, to thank you, Lord, for everything. Enjoy the sacred music, and I will see you next Sunday. Thank you.